Hello, everyone. Welcome. I think we'll get started. My name's Maggie Lind, and I am the Associate Director for Academic Programs and Public Education at the Smith College Museum of Art, and we're happy to see you all here today on a rainy, dreary Wednesday. I just want to take this opportunity to remind everyone to silence their cell phones. And just to comment that the lighting tonight, we're going to keep the lighting a bit higher than maybe you're used to in a slide lecture. Hopefully it feels like the slides are nice and crisp and clear. We're trying to get a good video of Martha tonight. So I hope you'll go with the lighting for tonight, and I think it should work well. So Martha Wilson's visit today marks the first program celebrating our current exhibition at the museum, Women's Work, Feminist Art from the Collection. This exhibition was developed by our own curators, April Gallant and Linda Mulig, and we've made two important acquisitions of Martha's work over the past several years at the museum, and those two works are really anchors of this show. I'll just make a note, we've got posted up here that our next program associated with this exhibition will take place on October 29th. Two of the Gorilla Girls will be joining us on campus, so we have a lot of feminists coming to shake things up here this semester. And we'll have an original member of this artist collective as well as a younger member of the group, so hopefully we'll see you there as well. And I'm just going to get Martha's PowerPoint ready to go, and then I'm going to turn it over to Lynn Yamamoto, a professor of art here at Smith, who's going to give a formal introduction of Martha and her work. Okay, Lynn.
Scrappy, smart, irreverent, ethical, and prescient. These words came to mind in thinking about Martha Wilson and her work. Wilson is an artist who works in performance, photography, and video. Her work explores the social dynamics of power through a feminist lens. The work is powerful, acerbic, and possesses a healthy dose of humor. She's presented work in places like Bucharest, Stockholm, Oslo, Berlin, and in New York at such venues as the Whitney Museum, Cooper Union, Printed Matter, and White Columns. Her very recent solo exhibitions have been at Mitchell Algis Gallery, PPOW, and at Fales Library at NYU. And there's been a kind of rapidly increasing kind of spate of exhibitions, which is very exciting, and very exciting for us here to share in. She's also the visionary founding director of Franklin Furnace, an artist-run venue presenting artist books, installation art, video, online and performance art that has recently evolved into a kind of, virtual institution nested in Pratt Institute in Brooklyn. Her degrees are in English literature, and she actually minored in art in undergraduate school. She lists on her resume editorial, curatorial, and interestingly, volunteer activities. I'm not sure what that constituted, but I thought that was fascinating. And she founded and collaborated with Disband, which is the all-girl punk conceptual band of women artists who cannot play any instruments. The awards she has received, though, I think aptly characterize the range of her practice and the expansiveness of her professional activities. So I'll just list a few of them. National Endowment for the Arts Fellowships and New York Foundation for the Arts Fellowship in Performance Art, but also the 2012 Yoko Ono Lennon Courage Award for the Arts, and Bessie and Obie Awards for commitment to artist freedom of expression. And I'd like to let Martha take the podium now, but please join me in welcoming Martha Wilson.
Thank you. Thank you, Lynn. That was beautiful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. It's always a good idea to start with boobs. So, this is a discussion of both halves of my brain, I had the idea, as many of us have, that we have our professional side and then we have the administrative side over here, and that the two don't meet, but we're going to prove today that it's all one big blob. Martha Wilson, breast forms permutated. Lynn said, I didn't major in art, I majored in English, and my boyfriend was the artist. Picture the United States of America in 1969. I graduated from college at the height of the Vietnam War. He didn't want to be drafted. I was raised Quaker. I didn't approve of the policies of Richard Nixon. We took it as a sign that we should leave America, so we went to Canada. I went to Dalhousie University, got an MA in English Literature. He was across the street at the Nova Scotia College of Art and Design getting an MFA in printmaking. I decided to be an artist very reluctantly and tentatively, and I think this is the first piece I ever did, for which I asked women if I could take photographs of their breasts. We have the flat-chested example in the upper left-hand corner, the full-breasted in the bottom right, pendulous, conical, and the perfect set is in the middle. I know that all these women went to the art college because the women who were going to Dalhousie University wore brassieres, and I didn't want their bra straps to show in the photos. This is my beautiful artist boyfriend who looked like Marcel Duchamp, so I dressed him up to look like Marcel Duchamp's female persona, Rose C'est la vie. But I didn't know what to do with his big beefy hand, so I kind of stuck it under the collar. And then years later, I moved to New York, and I saw the original Man Ray photograph of Duchamp as a woman, and I read the caption, and the way he did it was he had a woman standing behind him putting her hands into the frame. That's how that image is so powerful. So I thought what I was doing was performance art. Vito Conti had come to town, and the kids were just way cooler at the art college, so I would hang out at the art college instead of in the English department. So this is an experiment in whether your expression made with the benefit of visual feedback into the mirror is more genuine of the emotion you're trying to show, or if your internal sense of mirrors is more genuine. So it's called composure, and you can see in the left side I'm composing my features into the mirror, and there's my boyfriend taking a picture of me behind. And in the right side, I'm composing my features directly into the lens of the camera without the benefit of visual feedback. And I would venture to say that the right side is more miserable. Here I am, posturing drag. I'm dressing up as a man who is dressing himself up to be a woman. So the hair is fake, the eyelashes are fake, the fingernails are fake. The boobs are not fake, but everything else. I am a 25-year-old woman trying to look like a 50-year-old woman who's trying to look like she is 25. It made me really anxious to be doing this. You know, when you're young, you think after you turn 30, it's all over. But I'm twice that old now, so I can tell you can still walk around. Posturing male impersonator Butch, 1973. This was my unsuccessful effort to pass as a man in men's rooms in Halifax. But the men, they were not fooled. They would just say, get out. And I hadn't taken my friend Diane Tor's drag king workshops yet. She teaches you the very first thing you do is you use an ace bandage to hold your boobs in. This is the piece that was acquired by Smith College. It's called A Portfolio of Models. These are the models that society holds out to women. We can be a goddess, we can be a housewife, a working girl, professional, earth mother, lesbian. And so I say in the text that accompanies these images that I've tried all these roles on for size, but really, you know, none of them fit. And so the only job left is to be an artist, which is to stand slightly outside of polite society as a reject, perhaps, and point at my own predicament and the condition that I was born into. Martha Wilson, I make up the image of my perfection, 1974. This is the best I can do with makeup. That's, you know, as good as I can look. Martha Wilson, I make up the image of my deformity, 1974. This is me using makeup to deform myself. We didn't have Photoshop. This is 1974. So I was in front of a white refrigerator. My friend Alan Comfort was manipulating the camera angle and the lighting, and I was using makeup to deform myself. Makeover. So this is my Demoiselle d'Avignon piece, where I took pictures of women's features that I liked better than my own, and then I pasted them over my own features. So all of this is happening in Halifax, Nova Scotia. Luckily for me, something happened. Thank you for being here.
Yes, no worries.
Okay. Lucy Lepard came to town, to Halifax, and looked at what I was doing and said, yes, you are an artist, and I know other women who are doing the kind of work that you're doing. She put me in a show called Circa 7500 that the catalog for which consisted of a pack of note cards, and I got the front and back of the note cards. So I put the breast forms permutated on one side, and I can't remember what I put on the other side. But through the catalog, I met artists in New York, and when my boyfriend dumped my ass, I moved to New York. I was making performances and publications, and everybody else was doing the same thing in Lower Manhattan, and the uptown institutions were paying no mind to this. So I started collecting what came to be known as artist books. This is Lawrence Wiener's statements. Here's one of his statements. One regular rectangular object placed across an international boundary, allowed to rest, then turned to and turned upon to intrude the portion of one country into the other. You can see, though, that the word breaks are not in the right place. What he's doing is making a brick of text out of this statement. Plus, it is instructions for a performance, right? We can take a sheet of plywood to the Canadian border, and then we can lay it down on the border and then intrude a portion of Canada into the United States. Or we can sit at home in our pajamas and read about it. As far as Lawrence Wiener is concerned, it's the concept. The concept is where the art resides, not actually in the book, which has a price on the outside of $1.95, not in the action of going to the Canadian border either. This is concept-driven art. So I moved to New York, and I had a loft, ground floor loft. I was making artist books, and I had started inviting artists to read. I called them artist readings. Every single artist showed up with props and other stuff. This is William Wegman's performance with his dog, Man Ray. It's all of 7 minutes, so I'm going to play the entire performance for you now.
Dip. I love the water. Even before I knew how to walk, I could swim. I was born with no mouth at all, just kind of a slit. Actually, I did have a mouth. Yesterday, I went to the laundromat to do my laundry. I'm in the wood business, and my brother is in the nail business. No, you're all wrong. Your whole rhythm's off. Of all the deodorants, this is the one I like best. Feels real good going on. Do you want to go to the beach? Oman, the pocketbook man is here. Just a drop for me, please. So this chick comes up to me. All right, I'll talk to you later. Just a drop for me, please. Whoops. You subtract the 30,000 from the 40,000, and you come up with the trip across country that's really pretty boring. You go through a lot of small towns, and you know it's mostly flat. I thought it would be more green. And what they teach you to do is they teach you to read only important words while you scan. B-E-A-C-H. Do you want to go see Gail? Where's Gary? Oh, wow, what a neat stick. Do you want to go for a bike ride? Boy, is it crooked. And seeing the woodchuck can chop as much wood as a woodpecker can peck birches relative to their own size. This must be more interested in me, I think. It says here, hello everyone and welcome to Franklin Furnace. And I'm the first on the list to read to you this evening. I am pleased to have been given the opportunity to read to you by Franklin Furnace. I have decided to read selections of my own writing. I've never done this before, have you? I have no pretensions about myself as a writer, but every so often, during times when I couldn't get the inspiration to work on my paintings, I would jot down little sayings or statements to amuse myself and pass the time. Here are some examples. I dedicate this pantheon to all the gods. Porson, a Greek scholar, could recite complete works of Milton backwards and forwards, but not correctly. Donuts are good for you because they are full of starch. Coupled with sugar, a donut becomes a tasty and nutritious between meal snack. I've written a few sayings about feet, and this is one. I know a man who wears his shoe on his foot. Not only does he wear his shoe on his foot, but he also wears his shoe on his foot. I think everybody in this room has at one time or another been concerned about their looks. My face has been lifted, and I look much better. Before, it sagged a little. Now it looks uplifted, and all my friends agree that my face looks less saggy. They agree with me when I say, I feel that I look much better. I'm sure many of you in the audience have at one time felt superior. Especially to people outside of New York, but also including New York. Although I have a high IQ, I can deal with everyday problems. And I enjoy meeting inferior people. My work is not so demanding that it takes up much of my time. So unlike other highly intelligent people, I have a lot of free time. I enjoy chatting in bars with different people I meet, and although the experience is valueless to me personally, I am talkative and amiable. I'm especially personable in the evening. This next one is about keeping the days and the month, the letters, the amount of letters in the month straight. A dozen days has September, December, and June. March, April, November, October, January, July, and April all has six, with the exception of April, which has 12. Now, just before I wind up with my finale, I'm just going to read two more short stories twice, and then unless you want to stay for the Bartlett reading, you can offer home. I was interested to learn that the man who invented the electric chair was also known for his work with young people. female girlfriend went up to her male boyfriend and said, "I'm having a good time, but I'm not having a ball." To which the male boyfriend replied, "Just have a ball." Cute. I was interested to learn that the man who invented the electric chair was also known for his work with young people. His parents owned a lumber company, and when they died, a female girlfriend went up to her male boyfriend and said, "I'm having a good time, but I'm not having a ball." To which the male boyfriend replied, "Just have a ball." Ray. I've always been an avid reader, but not in public. I have a large collection of books at home. I have a high esteem for writers. Just hearing their names gives me a feeling of awe and turns my head. George Bernard Shaw.
This is the front of Franklin Furnace in 1978 with a piece by Jenny Holzer in it called Truisms, text as image. This was a radical concept at the time. Somebody drove down Franklin Street and threw a nut, a big one like this, through the plate glass window, and it went through the phrase, "Boredom makes you do crazy things." So that's Mike Glear, her husband, taking a picture of the hole, which you can't really see too well in the slide, in the plate glass window. Franklin Furnace was collecting what we came to call artist books. I think that's a terrible term, because the word book usually refers to something outside of itself, and this was all objects that were referring back to themselves. And they weren't all Kodaks anyway. Eleanor Anton's 100 Boots postcards, she mailed them out sequentially, like every month. So you would read the picaresque novel of the adventures of the 100 Boots each month. Conrad Glieber's meat book has male meat and female meat shrink-wrapped into a sandwich. Barbara Kruger, No Progress in Pleasure. Suzanne Lacy, Rape Is, You Have to Rape the Book in Order to Read It. Bruce Nauman, oh dear. Bruce Nauman's Lair, Los Angeles Air. These are photographs of Los Angeles Air, 12 inches by 12 inches. Ken O'Hara's One, about 500 pages of faces with the foreheads, chins, ears cut off. Just the central part of the face that the baby recognizes. And after 500 pages, you recognize that young, old, male, female, white, black, we are all one. This is probably the most significant book in our collection, Klaus Oldenburg's Ray Gun Poems, 1960. He published them on paper left over at Judson Memorial Church from protest marches on a Gestetner. You probably don't know what that is. It's some kind of cylinder with film on it. You scratch away the film, and that's how you get the image. I asked him how many Ray Gun poems were in the edition. He said fatigue was a factor. Dieter Rose, Bach 3D consists of comic book pages punched full of holes, bound right side up and upside down. He is Swiss. Ed Ruscha, Every Building on the Sunset Strip, is an accordion book. And it's you can see the little tiny numbers. These are
you know, there are motorized cameras pointing out each side of a car driving down the Sunset Strip, so it's literally every building on the Sunset Strip. Daniel Martini's Obscene Is, it's a set of condoms. So the term book, we used it because it's convenient, but you can see that what artists were publishing covered a lot of ground. In 1980, I figured out that there was nobody critiquing and discussing what the downtown community was doing either, so we started to publish a magazine, The Flu. This is Barbara Kruger's design of The Flu, and in the centerfold of this issue, there's a photograph of book pages by Alberto Moravia. This is a piece of appropriation art by Barbara Kruger, also Louise Lawler, and Sherry Levine. So the Simon & Schuster Publishing Company found out that Franklin Furness had quoted more than the allowable amount of text without paying royalties, so we got a bill for $50, and it's 1980, bill is for $50, and I made the archivally regrettable decision of publishing this Flu on newsprint. When you start an arts organization, you just should stay away from newsprint. The artists who were contributing their artist books to our collection were also doing performance art and street actions. So I invited feminists from Los Angeles and feminists from London. Actually, I invited two curators. Suzanne Lacey curated the feminists from Los Angeles, and Susan Hiller curated the feminists from London to meet in New York, to come together and meet in New York, to see if feminism was different in different parts of the planet. Here in this performance, the feminist art workers are figuring out that collaboration is imperative. They can't feed themselves, their arms are too short, so they have to feed each other. Rose English's Adventure or Revenge was a critique of the Actor's Handbook. There's a manual that is used in England that she deconstructs as a misogynist document. Tina Keen had a video camera pointed at the audience, so Tina Keen is in the crib, but she's videotaping the audience. Plus, she has another videotape of a baby girl through to a woman of 80 about the cage that we're, as women, born into when we're born second rate. Leslie Labowitz starts this performance. Naked on the bed of earth you see at the bottom of the screen, in darkness, explaining that her childhood was filled with images of death. Her mother was an Auschwitz survivor. So she grew up and became an adult and decided to make her art out of life. She starts a bean sprout business. At the end of this performance, she sold the business to somebody in the audience. This, the sprout man is over on the right. He's singing on the piano. Ana Mendieta's performance at Franklin Furness in 1982, Body Tracks, was silent, ritualistic. Teaching Shea, who came to this country and lived in a cage for 1 year and punched a time clock for 1 year, every hour for 1 year. Then he lived outside for 1 year. This is his third performance. Photographs summer, winter, spring, and fall. These are the clothes that he wore when he was living outside for a year, so you know he really did live outside for a year. And these are maps of 365 days, where he slept, where he walked, where he took a bath in a hydrant, where he took a shit in the curb. So Franklin Furness was merrily presenting what the downtown avant-garde art community was doing. Jackie Apple was the curator from 1976 to 1980, and then she moved to Los Angeles, and we started a peer review system that we still use today, where we have we receive proposals from artists, and they get selected once a year, the following year. We selected 9 women artists and activists who wanted to ask if there could be such a thing as feminist pornography. Their collective was called Carnival Knowledge. One of their performances consisted of a performance of porn stars. These are the activists, the artists, and the porn stars, but they have switched their labels, so we no longer know which ones are the curators and which ones are the porn stars. Well, we know who some of them are. there was installation and performance on upstairs and also downstairs in the basement. And here's the manifesto that was on the wall when you came in the front door. As feminists, we find that pornography can give us freedom to explore sex. We also recognize the demeaning effect it has on both women and men. Many people feel that pornography is a major factor in society's negative attitude towards women and would prefer to get rid of it completely. We wish to present a new way of looking at pornography that would enable people to see its distortions and recognize the value of their own sexuality as well as that of all people. So you can see that there are artist books, we had phone sex, we had performance art upstairs and down. This is the Deep Inside Porn Stars performance where 1, 2, 3, 4. Fifth from the left is Annie Sprinkle. She just died and I can't remember her name right now. Candida Royale is the woman all the way on the left. Here they are mooning the audience. We had mud wrestling upstairs, Jennifer Miller. And Susan, I forget her last name, saxophone dancing. The boobs would waft on your face as you were going downstairs. So as soon as this show closed, the Morality Action Committee picketed the organization and wrote postcards to all of our funders and to the local legislators. Saying that we had shown pornography to 500 children per day. This was, for us, the beginning of the culture wars. The beginning of the culture wars was perhaps when Dennis Barry did the Mapplethorpe show out in Ohio, and his ass got fired for that exhibition. And it would grind along with David Warnerovich suing the Donald Wildman for taking an image of his out of context. He won the suit. He won a dollar at the end of that process. But I believe the religious right won the culture wars. And they won the culture wars with one of the ideas that you'll see in this slide. I don't know if you can figure out what was the most saleable idea. What?
New York State Arts Council.
New York State Arts Council. Get rid of it. I think the one that was nationally useful was the tax, no taxes for religious bigotry. Your tax dollars are being used to support obscene art. This was the idea that the religious right sold to our great nation, and we can talk about the culture wars at length later on. Meanwhile, Franklin Furness started a literacy program at PS 130 in Chinatown across the street, and we turned 10 years old. This is from our 10th birthday. Thank you. We presented performance art on the Staten Island Ferry to people who are trying to get to work reading their newspapers. We presented, installation work on the outside of the 112 Franklin Street building. This is Willie Cole's 10,000 Mandelas. Images of Nelson Mandela that are barbed wired to the front window. And there's a soundtrack as you go by. Mandela, 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 people going to the courthouses. At this point, Nelson Mandela had been in solitary confinement for some years, and there was no indication he would ever be let out. Around 1980 or so, this is 89, I recognized that the uptown institutions were not only not paying attention and not collecting what the downtown community was doing, but they're also not filling in the history of the artist book movement, so I started to do that too. We didn't own any of these works. We borrowed them from collectors so we could show the avant-garde book 1900 to 1945. This was curated by Yaroslav Andel, and it contained a work which I believe started the discourse about alternative places where art could exist. This is Stefan Mallarmé's Un coup de dé, published in 1897. A throw of the dice will never eliminate chance. Un coup de dé jamais n'abolira le hasard. You can see that the page itself is being used as art space, and that the sizes of the type are different, so that your eye is composing this poem. You're kind of drifting around this space and picking up the stuff that you think is important first. It's an interactive work of art using the page as art space. It was discussed in Cafe Society among musicians and painters and poets and playwrights and pretty much everybody, and I believe it is one of the foundational documents of avant-garde art expression, which continues today. Meanwhile, back in Lower Manhattan, Karen Finley did her first performance in New York at Franklin Furnace. She took a bath in a suitcase. She made love to a chair using Wesson cooking oil. No problem. This is standard downtown fare. But then she did Constant State of Desire, for which she smeared her breasts with chocolate frosting and then sprinkle bean sprouts over that, and then glitter over the whole thing to embody and magnify the condition of women in our society. And she became branded as the chocolate-smeared young woman by two conservative newspaper columnists, Evans and Novak. And she became the symbol of the culture wars. There were four artists who were denied grants from, they received the grants from the panels, but then the National Council denied them. It was Karen Finley, Holly Hughes, John Fleck, and Tim Miller. Or as Holly Hughes put it, Karen Finley and the three homosexuals. Anyway, Karen made the case to us that while she had emerged as a performance artist, she was still emerging as an installation artist. So my panel selected her work, her proposal for A Woman's Life Isn't Worth Much, for an installation at Franklin Furnace in 1990. And you can see that she's drawing and painting directly on the walls. Why can't that veal calf walk? The story of Aunt Mandy, who died from an illegal abortion. Job seeking, if you're pregnant, you won't get it. If your flat stomach is flat, you'll get it. If you don't shave your legs, no one will like you. Smooth is what men like. So I called John Fronmeyer, who was the current chair at this time, and said, look, come to New York and see that Karen Finley's work is not obscene. It's about the condition of women in our society. But he declined to come. I'm taking you through the first 30 years of Franklin Furnace's life by picking out one project for each of those years that I think says something about where the culture was at. This performance by William Pope Bell is called How Much Is the Nigger in the Window, 1991. And it consisted of an installation and a performance in the front window for which he's straddling a videotape of his crawl. He did a crawl in Tompkins Square Park, which I'll show you in a second. And he did a performance in the front window for which he smeared his skin with mayonnaise in an attempt to become white. Of course, the mayonnaise oxidized and he just became very shiny. This is the installation. And this is the crawl. He's crawling in the gutter in Tompkins, outside of Tompkins Square Park, wearing a very nice three-piece suit. And a black guy walked across the street and said, "Get up!" He was denigrating the image of black people by crawling in the gutter. It was the three-piece suit. I mean, had he been wearing tattered clothes, he would be a homeless black guy and we wouldn't even look. He's wearing this beautiful three-piece suit. The culture wars are still cranking along, and in 1985, we got a call from the National Endowment for the Arts that we were going to be audited by their auditing division. We also got a call from the New York State Comptroller. They wanted to audit us too. And then there was a third one. The IRS. The IRS wanted to audit us too. So it was depressing because you can't complain. You can't say, you're just auditing me for political reasons. You have to like show up with all the paper that they want. This went on for 10 years. And near the end of the 10 years, we were going a little nuts. So we selected a proposal from Nicole Eisenman and Chris Miller for the Lesbian Museum, 10,000 Years of Penis Envy, because we thought, if we can't laugh, we're gonna die. It was an exhibition of dildos, both contemporary and historical, and we didn't get shut down for the show. This is Sharin Nashat's first solo show in New York, unveiling face-to-face 1993. And what I like so much about seeing these images is that if you are familiar with her mature work, you can see all of her concepts right here in this early stuff that she was doing at Franklin Furnace in 1993. Dolores Zorigueto is born in Argentina. This is a piece that consisted of thigh-sized cocoons suspended on monofilament at precisely the same height, but as you come in the gallery, they're kind of wafting around a little bit, maybe because of the rotation of the earth or air movements. Or anyway, it made me feel like I wanted to hurl. It's a piece about the disappeared of Argentina. They're cocoons covered in Band-Aids. Dan Perzhovsky, Anthroprogramming, 1995. Dan Perzhovsky from Romania, on the first day of his show, started doing these portraits 2 inches by 2 inches in pencil on the wall, thousands and thousands of these portraits on the wall. And then on December 1st, which is the day without art, the day that the visual arts world sets aside to mourn the devastation of AIDS, he erased his show. So now we're, you know, getting to the end of the 90s. The culture wars are still with us. We decide as a board of directors and an organization, we have meetings and decide we're going to offer artists the next free zone of space, which is on the internet. But before we go virtual, we're going to have one last fling. So we did this show called Voyeur's Delight about the power of looking, containing, it was a group show containing one piece by Jocelyn Taylor with a mirrored floor and little video monitors inset in the floor that are images of her vagina with a speculum spreading her vagina so we can look right up her snatch. Now, of course, if you're standing on the mirrored floor, people can look right up your skirt, too. It's a piece about the invasive quality of American medical practice on women's bodies. Now we are at the very last show in physical space. It was called In the Flow, Alternate Authoring Strategies, and it examines how, during the 20 years of Franklin Furnace's existence, art has changed from solid to liquid. By which I mean, all the way on the left, on the left wall, you can see a wall drawing by Saul LeWitt. He famously doesn't do his own drawings. He gives you a 3x5 card with some instructions, and then you hire somebody else to do the drawing. On the right are posters by the Guerrilla Girls. Deeper inside are pieces by Louise Lawler. Thing.net. Thing.net is an online space for artists. So it was a show about how the sole authorship of the heroic individual artist has eroded in the last 20 years and turned into a collaborative process whereby people who are artists or identified as artists might collaborate with people who are waiters and waitresses, or, you know, there are all kinds of combinations and social ways that art is being created. So now we have gone virtual. Our website is our public face, but we decided to make sure that the images and the texts couldn't be separated anymore, as David Warnerovich's image was taken out of context, and although he sued successfully, it took him, you know, 2 years or something, we made sure that we put up the images that the artists were creating of Jocelyn Taylor's vagina with a speculum up there, but we have the artist's explanation with it. And we started collaborating with a .com company, pseudo.com, to present performance art on the internet. This is the first one that we ever presented 1998, Helona Hilbert's pseudo studio walk, where she walks up to the camera, she's got all this hair, then she turns and her bushy hair fills up the screen. Then she walks into the loft, then she walks up to the camera, then she walks into the loft, then she walks up to the camera, then she walks into the loft. This goes on for 50 minutes, 50 minutes. You're thinking, what is she doing? What she's doing is she's doing a performance about the new time and space that exists on the internet. The performance occurred on such and such a date in 1998, and then it was uploaded to Pseudo's server, so at Smith College we could download it and look at the performance 6 months after the fact. So time has just gone to hell, and space. You know, the performance was on Houston Street, but we're not in Houston Street, we're here in Northampton, Massachusetts. So time and space just went to hell because art is being presented on the internet. This is a wonderful performance by Deborah Admiotti's that's too long, so I'm just gonna show you the beginning. Deborah Admiotti's The Fancy Ladies.
The fancy ladies are extremely fancy and also very, very rich.
They're singles. when we went virtual, I thought the body of the artist would go away. And this is a completely virtual performance by Jack Waters, with avatars controlled by people all over the world meeting in a virtual space and interacting with each other, playing the game that he's calling Super Schmoozio, the game of the art market, where you find out you have to stab other people in the back in order to advance your career. Ricardo Miranda Zuniga is exploring the original form of radio. Whoops. The original form of radio was a two-way. Oh, we're skipping him. All right.
You want to go back?
We could go back.
There we go.
Oh, thank you. It's an online radio station on a shopping cart that he wheels around to public parks. Radio was originally a two-way medium, and then it became a one-way medium, so he is taking it back to the people. Yuri Gitman and Joshua Kinberg got a Franklin Furnace Fund grant for their magic bike, which accepted text messages on a cell phone on the handlebars and then sprayed them on the street when the bicycle was driving down the street with this mechanism on the back. Their idea was to participate in the Republican National Convention with their project called Bikes Against Bush. But Mayor Bloomberg, a Republican, prophylactically arrested the artists and activists in advance of the Republican National Convention. And in a minute, you're gonna see the police impounding the bike. They ultimately lost the bike, but not before the bomb squad took apart the machine and complimented the artist on what a cool machine it was. He then had to fight, cost him $30,000 to get his reputation back. This is how we treat artists. This is the real thing. We're coming up on 30 years, and Franklin Furness was invited to exhibit exhibit itself as an anti-institutional institution. So I invited a sociologist, performance artist, Britta Wheeler, to create this map, performance art and its institutionalization, a map. What is avant-garde art? What is live art, performance? What is art? What is an institution? And she analyzed High Performance magazine in order to get the results. This is our actual 30th birthday party. It was at White Box, a piece by Wulu Productions. They invited artists from foreign countries to apply for an opportunity to live in the gallery in a cell. You're going to see their cells and cajole art materials from the public. The artist who won got a meeting with an attorney to get an O-1 visa where they could live legally in the country for a number of years. And the way she won was she got masking tape. Since their cells were made of masking tape, she got masking tape from somebody in the public and taped her way out the door. So Wulu thought that was a pretty good solution. So during all this time, Martha's an artist, and thank you, Lynn, for mentioning that I founded Disband, the all-girl band of women artists who couldn't play any instruments. But you can see that we did play some, I mean, we played newspapers, we played rocking chair, flag. Some of our songs, this one is called Irany, I-R-A-N-Y. I guess our biggest hit was Look at My Dick, which Ilona and Diane put garden hose up their pants, and then they came out and pulled their dicks out and started whirling their dicks around their heads. Look at my dick. No, look at my dick. My dick is longer than your dick. So Disband was active from 1978 to 1982, and then we disbanded. At the end of Disband, we were members of Ronald Reagan's cabinet, and I was Alexander M. Plague Jr. So I did a performance as Alexander, one as Ronald Reagan, and then I found Nancy. I was Nancy Reagan for both of Ronald Reagan's terms. At the same time that this was going on, there were women in Lower Manhattan who were asking, what do these artists have in common? The Guerrilla Girls reviewed the behavior of the major cultural institutions in New York, and went around the world to explain the advantages of being a woman artist, working without the pressure of success, not having to be in shows with men, having an escape from the art world in your 4 freelance jobs, knowing your career might pick up after you're 80, being reassured that whatever kind of art you make, it will be labeled feminine, not being stuck in a tenured teaching position, seeing your ideas live on in the work of others, having the opportunity to choose between career and motherhood, not having to choke on those big cigars or paint in Italian suits, having more time to work after your mate dumps you for someone younger, being included in revised versions of art history, not having to undergo the embarrassment of being called a genius, getting your picture in the art magazines wearing a gorilla suit. I had a son. I didn't ever think I would do that, but this is Tipper Gore's advice for the 90s. The reason I started doing Tipper instead of Hillary is that when Bill Clinton was elected, he came out at the MTV inaugural ball. It's this huge ballroom with a causeway, you know, a catwalk, whatever, runway. The sea of youth all around. He's playing the saxophone. Our president is playing the saxophone. The youth of America is like overjoyed. So Bill comes out first, Hillary comes out after, Al comes out, yeah, all stiff, right? And then Tipper came out, and the mood in the room changed. They booed her off the stage at the MTV inaugural ball. They booed Tipper Gore off the stage. Why did they do that? Does anybody remember? Yes.
She was against what she called bad language in music. She wanted it eliminated.
She put parental advisory labeling on records. It's still there, and CDs, that little orange tag that parents should beware of the lyrics in this whatever. Yes. The youth of America had not forgotten. They booed her off the stage, and I decided I was going to do Tipper during the Clinton years. I got wedded to a fishmonger. And started doing Barbara Bush.
I'm Barbara Bush, ex-First Lady of the United States, wife and confidant of George Herbert Walker Bush, 41st President of the United States, mother and confidant of dead Bush, ex-governor of the great state of Florida, mother and confidant of George W. Bush, 43rd president of the United States. If power is the ultimate aphrodisiac, I guess you might say I'm the sexiest woman in the free world. Oh, am I kidding? I'm all washed up!
This is half of the piece that Smith College has acquired. It's a videotape called Deformation from 1974.
This is about the best I can do with makeup. The camera angle is high. It reduces my chin. I like hollow cheeks, and I don't have them, so I try with the camera angle to make up for that. I'm going to deform myself in the way that I fear the most, all the ways that I fear the most, by using makeup and using camera angles. I haven't got any wrinkles yet, but I'm going to get. I have a lump on the side of my nose. I'm going to exaggerate my double chin. If I call attention to the things that I fear the most, then I know that I really don't look this way most of the time. Makes me feel a lot better if I see myself this way and I know I don't look like that, even though this is what I fear I look like. Now I'm going to give myself wide lips. And I'm going to show my teeth, which I'm also embarrassed about. That's pretty bad. It's pretty ugly.
Martha Wilson, I've Become My Own Worst Fear, 2009. This was the title of the show at PPOW Gallery in 2011 that consisted of works that have fun with getting older. This is a piece called Growing Old. This is Mona, Martha, Marge, 2009, which forms the basis of my show at PPOW opening October 22nd. This one is called now Mona, Marcel, Marge. Marcel Duchamp drew on a postcard of the Mona Lisa, a mustache and a goatee. So I've made lenticular photographs so you can see Mona, Martha, Marge from this angle, and Mona Marcel Marge from that angle. Martha Wilson, new wrinkles on the subject. I asked a makeup artist to incise all of my wrinkles. This is a spoof of a TV ad. I don't know if you have it up here. It's called a company called Lifestyle Lift. It's facelifting, so this is a portrait of me upside down. Martha Wilson, bear in mind, bear in hind. It's kind of a long story. I was invited to be part of a calendar as a panda bear, and I was the only artist who thought about hiring somebody to do body paint, which gave me the idea to do this piece. Clifford Owens asked me to do Michelle Obama at the Next Wave Festival in October of 2014. I asked Saya Wolfock, who's a black woman performance artist and friend of mine, she said, you should refuse the invitation. I asked Lorraine O'Grady, and she said, well, you could do it, but, you know, not with blackface. So I decided to do it with half of my face made up as Michelle. And then before I came out on stage as Michelle Obama, I showed 30 years of me impersonating first ladies so that the audience could tell that Clifford Owens was not inviting me to be Michelle out of a vacuum. I still thought people were going to throw tomatoes, but what actually happened was Elizabeth Weatherford was sitting in the audience, and Clifford wants the audience and the artist to talk to each other, and Elizabeth Weatherford said, Martha, if you were Michelle, you would own the room. Your shoulders would be down. You'd be looking everybody in the eye. You'd be completely relaxed instead of coming out like a rabbit. Right. So maybe I should have called this show I'm Going to Die. This is the concluding image of the show, and it's a t-shirt that I got in 1977 from my friend Lynn Tillman when I slipped in the shower and figured out that I was mortal and I was going to die. I invited Lynn Tillman to come to Magoo's and have a drink, and I said, Lynn, I'm going to die. She said, Martha, we're all going to die. The end. Thank you.
Take some questions, and we have a couple of students with microphones who can run them to you if you have a question.
So I also do a lot of performative work, and of course it's one of the kind of versions of art making that doesn't generate income. So I'm wondering about your funding streams, because there's been so much work that sounds like you've given grants for your own work, for other artists' works.
Through Franklin Furnace, just if you can.
How do I pay for it?
How? Yes, as we struggle in
2015. Yes. Yes. Plus, in the 70s when. We were doing work in Lower Manhattan. We were undermining the commercial gallery system. We wanted to destroy it if possible, and we didn't understand why art had to be bought and sold and hung above people's couches. So all that street action and performance work was designed to question the art system that we came into. So I invented a day job that would pay me to have a night job. And that's my advice to art students, is to make sure you have a day job so you can do whatever you damn well please, because if you're beholden to the commercial system, as many artists are, I don't know how you live with yourself to do that. But now that I've sold two pieces to Smith College. I can tell you it's very gratifying to get paid for this kind of work. And I was just at a lecture, Dred Scott, who believes in armed overthrow of the United States government. I mean, he's selling work. And how do you reconcile those two positions? Armed overthrow of the United States government and selling work. It's all one big blob is really the answer. I think we thought there were two halves of the brain, and now we realize that they talk to each other. I don't have an answer to your question, really. Oh, thank you, thank you.
I was wondering if you could assist in
yes.
this current climate.
Yes. After the culture wars hit the art world, they moved on to the academic world, and now you have to have, I don't know if you have to have this at Smith, but if you have an economics department, you have to have conservatives and liberals in the economics department to provide balance to the students so they can see all sides of an issue. And now I think the culture wars are even worse than they were during the culture wars of the 90s, because science itself is being questioned and intellectual activity itself is being questioned as a valid and worthwhile activity for our culture to be engaged in. And Donald Trump is the most popular Republican candidate, the one who doesn't even study up before he stands up in front of the entire nation and says that Mexicans are rapists. I don't have an answer for that question either, I'm sorry. Thank you for that question. I can answer that one. I was going to start a bookstore for artist books and call it the Franklin Stove because we were on Franklin Street in Lower Manhattan. But Willoughby Sharp, publisher of Avalanche magazine, who lived on the top floor and who kind of got the net lease together for the whole building, said, no, no, you must call it Franklin Furnace. And he was correct. You know, it completely stuck from day one. There was another question over there.
Martha, since you give out grants for performance artists annually, and you get submissions from all over the world, where do you think performance art now meets the visual arts, and whether is it on top, bottom, or if that's a good way? But where is that convergence right now, and where is it coming from?
Thank you, Juana, for asking that question. That's a very good question. Performance art was inside the doors of Franklin Furnace in the early days for a bunch of other performance artists. So we could, you know, we had a community, we would look at each other's work. Then the culture wars happened, and grants to individual artists were revoked. Franklin Furnace, Creative Capital, certain organizations made sure that there was still grant money available to artists, because we raised it from Jerome Foundation and other sources, and then we re-grant it to performance artists. And some of the spaces were disappearing as well, where they were supposed to be doing their work. I think that the legislators wanted to eliminate grants to performance artists to shut them up, but what really happened was the artists went outside and started doing their work for an unwitting audience, you know, regular people. For example, 2012, Qin Qi Yang collected 30,000 aluminum cans, and then he built a globe to contain them, and then he drove the globe out to the Unisphere, which is the 1965 World's Fair Unisphere in Flushing Meadows Park, Queens. Then he dumped the 30,000 aluminum cans on his head in front of the Unisphere for a piece he called Kill Me or Change, about our culture of waste, because each one of us in this room will probably use 30,000 aluminum cans in the course of our lives. We were freaked out because we didn't know if he was going to die as a result of his work, so we got an ambulance corps over on the side. 30,000 aluminum cans dumped on his head. He was up to here in aluminum cans, and he started swimming out of the pile, and then he cut his hand. And the ambulance corps was overjoyed. They had, you know, he didn't die, and they had something to do. I was overjoyed because the art world showed up. There were about 150 people who came out. But there are soccer moms, people picnicking, people going to play tennis. Regular people are out there looking at this art event take place. So I think the way we are going to continue to follow our subversive inclinations is by doing our work out in the regular world.
I'm not sure if this is a question so much as an aha moment that I just had when we were talking just now, but it seems to me, when you say, like, Franklin Furness, you were starting out intending to open a bookstore, and it just seems to me that there were so many artists in the 70s who were actually taking as much as they were trying to imagine spaces outside of the commercial art world and the decommercialization of art, that they were actually taking up really entrepreneurial models of working, like, you know, Franklin Furness as a bookstore.
Right.
Or Gordon Matapart's cafeteria.
Taking,
or,
yes.
You know, the restaurant. You know, that there, it seems to me that there were a lot of artists kind of playing with those
institutions. Yeah.
Institutions, but specifically kind of like business institutions.
Right, businesses.
Right, occupying those spaces.
Right.
So I was wondering if you maybe had anything to say about that. Or you can just not, but, you know, but I thought, you know, it is sort of a very kind of, it seems to be something that was in the air at that moment.
So when I, in the early days of Franklin Furness, when I was starting out, I called my friend Ann Folk, who was starting a gallery called Andor Gallery in Seattle, and complained that the administration took up so much time that there really wasn't much time left over for art. She said, why can't we consider our administrative practice to be an artistic practice? It was like, ding! Oh, it's all one blob. It's, you know, everything you're doing, you're problem solving, you're responding to conditions as they change. The other thing that I thought in the earliest days was, I will figure out the formula for how to raise money for this thing. No. It's a new crapshoot every single year because the political environment changes, everything, the economic environment changes. So it's like being an artist. You have to figure it out new on a continuum. But my advice to Dixon Place when they moved to their new space was to get her liquor license.
Well, maybe we'll stop there. Thank you so
on
much.
On the liquor license.
Yeah.
Yay! Thank you.